Hello everyone, let's talk about the spinal cord and the spinal meninges. So what you're looking at here is a posterior view of the neck and thorax on a donor on which a laminectomy has been performed. So if you recall, the laminae are the most posterior parts of the vertebral arch. And on either side, what's happened here is that these laminae have been sawed through so that we can expose the contents of the vertebral canal, namely the spinal cord within the meninges. And here we can see the outside of the dural sheath. And so the dura mater, dura meaning tough and mater meaning mother. So the tough mother or dura mater is the exteriormost meninge or covering of the central nervous system. Now the spinal meninges are contiguous with the cranial meninges, and there are some differences between the cranial dura and the spinal dura, but we'll see those in a later session. So once you have the C-spine laminectomy performed, you should be able to see the dura mater, the dural sac, laterally. So while we're here, let's kind of erase that. We can also see how the dural sac extends on the proximal portions of the spinal nerves. So it creates an environment that's protective of those nerves, extending out through the intervertebral foramina. On this particular donor, we're looking at a postero right lateral view with the dura mater incised and then reflected away. And what we can see here are all three layers of the meninges. So dura mater, the tough mother, is the most external. Now, sitting right up against the dura mater is the arachnoid mater. And in this case, the arachnoid mater has delaminated away from the dura. So normally these two layers would be right on top of one another. But owing to the vicissitudes of the embalming and dissection process, the arachnoid mater, arachnoid meaning spidery mother, tends to delaminate, and we have an extra space here that isn't present in vivo. Now, extending down to the pia mater, you can see all of these little fibers. So the arachnoid mater creates this mesh network of fibers from its bulky layer down to the pia mater, which we'll see shortly. This network, this spongy network, is going to prescribe the subarachnoid space. And it's within this subarachnoid space that we have cerebrospinal fluid. So the CSF is going to exist in this area. And it's that CSF that kind of bathes the central nervous system with fluid. It helps cushion and preserve it, helps to move away waste products, etc. So let's erase these for the time being. Directly upon the central nervous system, to the extent that one can't peel it away, is the pia mater. Pia means soft or delicate. So this is the soft mother, to have some contrast with the hard mother. And the Pia Mater is just, it's everything here that one can see that we would identify as the central nervous system. So all throughout, all of this is Pia Mater. And we can see here are some, I'll highlight the group. Those are dorsal rootlets that are heading down towards the intervertebral foramen there. And up here, while we have the opportunity, this has been dissected away. This is a dorsal root ganglion. So when you hear the DRG, and so there would be the spinal trunk. And extending this way would be the dorsal primary ramus. And extending that way out laterally, not the small bit, but this larger piece, that would be the ventral primary ramus on its way out. We can see here the C-spine with the dura mater removed. We can see some of those dorsal rootlets here and the DRG. There's the DPR. The VPR is heading out laterally. We can also see collections of these dorsal rootlets moving down and out left and right laterally. And between the two, here, see this white structure? That's a denticulate ligament. Denticulate ligaments are extensions of the pia mater, which help to separate the dorsal and the ventral rootlets. So you may see those. This region in particular is so large because we have what's known as the cervical enlargement. So we've got there. See how this is much larger than the spinal cord here. There are two enlargements of the spinal cord. There's a cervical and a lumbosacral enlargement. These are areas of the spinal cord which are larger to account for a higher density of nuclei in the ventral horns of lower motor neurons that are serving the limbs. So the cervical enlargement is going to be serving the upper limb. The lumbosacral enlargement will be serving the lower limb. And then finally here, we have a transverse section of the vertebral column and the spinal cord, as well as the spinal meninges. The vertebral foramen has been removed, so someone has performed a laminectomy here. We can see right there would be the vertebral body, perhaps a little bit of the intervertebral disc. Here are the meninges, and right here is the spinal cord. Well, you might notice a difference of contrast within the tissues of the spinal cord, so I'll just highlight that here. What you're looking at externally is white matter. White matter is for a lot of communication. And internally here is the gray matter. Gray matter largely is for integration. And so we can see examples of dorsal horns there. Dorsal horns would be where there are synapses between afferents coming in, and then there are ventral horns there. Ventral horns are for synapses of efferents, which are going out. So we've discussed a little bit of the spinal cord and a very high-level view of its tissues, as well as the spinal meninges and the features thereof. Thank you very much for your time.